The problem we are investigating is the inequality in opportunities between schools in regard to post-16 options.
Looking at the two schools I went to, you can see that there's quite a difference in terms of like what opportunities they have.
So I see in the morning, if I come early enough, you know, across the campus, I see lots of the students get the train and they walk across the campus. And I think for those students, the idea of going to university and what a university is just kind of a natural everyday part of their experience. There will be young people in this city who've never stepped on a university campus, even though they live in Birmingham where there's three universities, you know, they will have no idea what a university is really, you know, so you can see there the kind of inequalities between what those young people who go to the private schools here will understand compared to pupils elsewhere.
But for when I was at school, I noticed a massive sort of difference between my setting and the setting that my friends were in. So in terms of the opportunities I had, they were much more plentiful compared to the local schools that my friends were going to. So my school was very much sort of about academic opportunities, but then like I said, speaking to my friends outside of the grammar who went to more comprehensive schools, they just didn't seem to be anything at all really.
A lack of opportunities can have psychological impacts, such as on a student's motivation, self-confidence and academic attainment, which can then go on to hinder a student's progression onto all types of higher education, such as university and apprenticeships.
I think the challenge is in persuading some young people, you know, creating the motivation to engage with those opportunities.
A key issue which causes these psychological impacts that needs to be worked on is the effect of the stereotype and stigma around certain schools and the expectations that students who attend these schools have. For example, a student may not pursue opportunities regarding university if the school has a low number of students who progress to such institutions. It can also affect the performance of students.
You know, where schools are known to be failing schools, it's as if the kids in them are failures and there is a stigma.
For example, Aronson and Steele developed the concepts of stereotype threat and spotlight anxiety. Stereotype threat is the fear of being judged on or conforming to a specific stereotype. Spotlight anxiety is where a person is placed in a situation where they feel the stress and pressure from said stereotype, which causes them to underperform. This can be applied to our problem. For example, a student who attends a stereotypically bad school may worry that they will conform to the stereotype of being unintelligent or not being able to get into university. This could contribute to their spotlight anxiety, causing them to underperform school.
There's definitely a stigma around particular schools and coming from certain schools and what that might mean for how you approach things as well. Once you've got a label attached to you and everyone just kind of goes, oh, well, you know, we won't bother with them because they're not interested. Even discussing university, I mean, when you're in an environment where none of your family's ever been, none of your friends have ever been, no one you know has ever been, and then you're in school and not even your teachers are talking about it or mentioning it, how do you know what's out there? And that was really concerning to me even when I was like 16 years old.
We are aware that a lack of motivation, self-confidence and all these other psychological impacts can also stem from outside the school. For example, parents play a key role in the development of these.
I think the culture of their family and community is probably extremely influential.
However, the role of the school should not be underestimated.
I think a parent's aspirations can, but you know, young people can rebel against those as well. I just think it's one factor.
Which is why we've taken a school-based approach, as we can easier tackle school factors in terms of post-16 opportunities, which affect motivation, self-confidence and attainment. In order to combat this issue, we have proposed a solution to enhance the number of opportunities available to students through creating a widening opportunities committee in order for schools to share their post-16 opportunities. The committee will be made up of students with two representatives from each school within their catchment area. This catchment area will include all types of schools, from private to grammar to states. The representatives will have one to represent Year 9 in Key Stage 4 and one to represent Key Stage 5. The committee will be a space for student reps to discuss the opportunities that they have at their schools, which can then be opened up to others. Suggestions can also be given on what students would like to see more of. Having spoken to experts, we got a positive response on oscillation.
There is also a phenomenon that I've been interested in throughout my work in Birmingham, relating to social capital. Social capital, simply put, consists of the networks and norms between people which enable them to get on and get ahead. And it's the kind of wealth that comes from interaction, the wealth from pupils being able to meet with different kinds of pupils in different contexts and learning from it. So the better resourced schools are better at creating those kinds of opportunities, and the children in those better resourced schools have more social capital. And I think it's a thing that we should be thinking about in education, and that's why I think your ideas about creating a website and connections could lead to that reduction of social capital.
If we can give young people a sense of agency, it's a really powerful and healthy kind of mindset to develop while they're at school.
I actually saw this in a school that was actually looking to take the UN Convention on Children's Rights as far as it could go and see how much power could be given to children, how many rights could be given to children. What worked was handing over power. So a group was set up, a bit like the group you envisage, to look at inclusion in the school. And it was a huge success because the children were just allowed to go off. Nobody controlled their decision making, their judgments. Nobody said what they thought was right or wrong. And the children came up with great ideas to change things in the school.
In order to further open up these opportunities and overcome transport and capacity issues, these events, where possible, will be digitalised and uploaded onto a website. This website will be a platform where there will be a calendar and list of the events that are available at each catchment schools. There will also be information about wider opportunities by external organisations in the Birmingham area. And it will also be a place where past tours can be saved and made instantly accessible for students.
It's interesting, isn't it, because there's been an increase in schools working together in clusters. So that's kind of been promoted all over the place. It was very heavily promoted in Birmingham. So I think schools are used to working together in that way.
I think sharing resources, not having every school doing the same thing in its own little space. And that has to be advantageous.
Social interaction is also key in improving motivation. According to a study by Archer and Lever, motivation was enhanced when children's learning activity was encouraged by social motives. Therefore, if there are less chances to engage with other students, this can therefore cause a reduction in motivation.
I think schools are really positive at working together. I think it's one of the best things that we can do in our education system is to crack open the school.